The Tempe Elementary candidates for tonight are Harvey Gibson, James Lemon, Patrick Morales, and Evan Rogers. So they are seated in alphabetical order, and when we will be asking questions, we will be rotating through alphabetical order. So the first question for tonight, starting for Mr. Gibson, will be, please describe one thing your district does well and one thing where your district can improve.
Oh, opening statements.
Oh, wait, sorry.
We could skip that.
I think you're required to do it.
Okay, so I guess I will start with an opening statement. My name is Harvey Gibson. I have a BS in education, have worked for Landings Credit Union for the past 11 years as a business development officer. For those of you that don't know, Landings is a former Tempe Credit Union. I am active in a number of nonprofit organizations in the community. TCH, the Centers for Rehabilitation, where I currently serve as chair. I'm past chair of Communities in Schools, an organization that keeps children in school. That's their whole focus. I serve on the Tempe Leadership Board and am a past member of Class 22 there. I'm running for school board for a number of reasons. First and foremost is to play a role in our children's success and their achievement, both now and in the future. There's lots of decisions that we have to make, and so that's why I decided to run. I think that the board has run very well. There's always things that we can improve upon, and I look forward to participating in that.
Mr. Lemon?
All right, thank you. My name is Jim Lemon. I've lived in Tempe since 1978. I'm a registered geologist and environmental planner. I work for the Arizona Department of Transportation and do a lot of safe routes and school programs throughout the state with other local governments. I earned the Army Commendation Medal for my service in Vietnam. For about 10 years, I taught geology and geography classes at Arizona community colleges, and I taught a risk assessment class at ASU. I have a master's in ASU geography, bachelor and undergraduate degrees at Mesa State College in Grand Junction, Colorado. Some of you may remember me when I chaired the Great Cardboard Boat Regatta 10 years down on Tempe Sound Lake, because I think it's important for particularly teenagers and youth, particularly young youth groups, to learn how to work with STEM principles and teamwork. And we raised, the Rotaries raised tens of thousands of dollars for children's charities over those 10 years. I've previously been on the Tempe Elementary Board. We've rebuilt 5 schools. We've opened 3 parental choice schools. We have over 2,200 out-of-district students whose parents choose to attend Tempe Elementary. We still have art, PE, and music in all our schools, and we have all day kindergarten. It's very important, because when you start the race behind, it takes time to catch up. And we know we have people from parents from over 60 different countries and even more languages than that spoken at home aside English. So we have some issues to deal with here in the urban environment. What I bring to the board is my technical experience with large projects and working with agencies and government, my teaching background, and particularly my public policy development and implementation work, both in the environmental arena here in Arizona at the national level, as well as here at the schools. I am looking forward to serving one more term on the board because the board needs to work on improving educational outcomes for all the kids. We're doing okay, but we can do better. I think Harvey emphasized that. We could do better. We need to keep our highly trained, qualified educational leaders, and we need to provide the support for the teachers, the parents, and the students to implement those programs. Finally, you know, we need to get a raise for the teachers and keep them. And I'm a state employee, and I get paid the same daily rate as our teachers do, the same education background. I know it's tough, and we struggle with that. And we need to focus on that, but you need to recognize that Arizona does not value government employees. We value them, and that's why the MNO override is so important. We have local control to decide what to do with that maintenance and operation money and give it to our teachers and keep it in the classroom. So thank you.
Mr. Morales?
Hi, my name is Patrick Morales, and I just wanted to start by saying that my focus has always been in political science, but specifically not to try to be a politician or anything like that, but specifically in nonprofit work and student rights, whether that's in kindergarten or up to the college level. My current job is the Vice President and Organizing Director for the Arizona Students Association, so that works on anything from tuition at U of A, interest rates to NAU, and organizing on campus at ASU. And what I hope to bring to the board specifically is going to be that organizing background, specifically grassroots, anything from veterans campaigns that we are running this year, sexual assault campaigns, and campaigns to help lower tuition, because the main reason that I ran is because of the privatization of education. This is happening at the college level, and it's okay there because they've seen it since kindergarten. So we really need to start at the bottom. And I do want to commend the Tempe Elementary Board for being one of the best districts in the state, especially when Arizona as a whole is last in the nation. And we definitely need to work on improving that. So that's kind of my call to action, to keep Tempe at the top of Arizona and to help hold the other districts along and by setting an example.
Mr. Rogers?
I'm Evan Rogers. I've been a local resident here for almost 20 years. I love this community. I found my sweetheart here on a blind date almost 20 years ago, which I was a freshman at age at the time, and she was working on her teaching degree. So what really got me into education was seeing her throughout her degree and then later going back and getting her master's in education and teaching for about 10 years in the Tempe High School District. She was certified ESL as well as teaching English and American literature, very passionate about literature. So I've got all these good books thanks to her that I missed out on in high school when I was finding the things to do. But I love the community. I echo a lot of what Mr. Lemon shared about keeping the money in the classroom and being more of an advocate for our teachers. I saw how hard my wife worked, and I know there's other areas in teaching where a lot of grading, but I think English might take the cake in some cases. There's an argument there, I'm sure, with all the essays and things. By the time she taught, she always had her papers in hand, grading papers on the beach or wherever we're on vacation. Our teachers are amazing, amazing individuals, definitely in the profession. And I want to see what we can do to, as Mr. Lennon also shared, was helping them get paid with their work. Now I think easily, and this might sound crazy, but double their salaries. Still have some work to do, what they do and the work they put in for our, really it's about the kids. So let me digress a little bit. Currently as a business owner, my office is in Tempe, just down the street here after college. I have four children now. I've seen my kids go to the elementary school district at Broadmoor. My oldest daughter is 11. She just started at Tempe Academy International Studies. And what I've also learned too is having my oldest daughter have an ADHD and some of the special needs on one hand and the giftedness on the other, I learned quite a bit in some of these struggles and what the classrooms and teachers can do. And interestingly, you know, how much more training could be offered to some teachers who work with students like that that are gifted and have special needs. So often the classroom is set up to just focus on the general mass of students and having them score, whereas I think we need to focus more on each individual child and their special needs and adjust the curriculum per teacher, per grade, or per classroom accordingly. So thank you for this opportunity to talk to you, and I look forward to some of the questions.
We will now be moving on to the questions section. Please try to keep your responses to a minute.
All right, so the first question, starting with Mr. Gibson. Please describe one thing your district does well and one thing where your district can improve.
Well, there's a lot of things that this district does very well. We educate children very well. We have highly trained teachers. They have a lot of professional development. So we have excellent teachers, and as a result, we do very well at teaching children and having them I would love to see every school be an A school, and this district be an A school, and I think that's a very achievable goal. The current board and the staff, administration, and leadership of this district has done a great job of moving this district forward. They believe in continual improvement, and they show that every day. So I would love to see them achieve that A rating.
Thank you. Mr. Levin?
Thank you. It's a great question, because there's a lot of things I believe the current administration is doing quite well in answering. And for example, almost most of our schools, as close to our students at all the schools, are achieving over 1 year's growth. And so we know our teachers are doing better. But we also know that some of our students aren't achieving over 1 year's growth, particularly in some of our areas that are more challenging. And that would be in the honors programs, and then in some of the children that are just not making it in the school environment. So I think we got to teach to all the kids. We got to expect them to make over a year's growth, whether they're currently doing that or whether they're not. And we need to sort that out, put those resources and focus those resources so all the kids make over 1 year's growth, because we have a long way to go if we're going to meet the standard. Thank you.
Mr. Morales?
Yeah, so as walking through the community, the best thing to do always is asking the parents what it is that they feel the district does the best. And like I said before, a lot of things are done well in this district. But the thing that kept being highlighted time and time again was the programming available to all of the students. The reason a lot of parents moved to Tempe, the reason they wanted to stay in Tempe, was programming. So I think definitely keeping that alive, especially asking for funds from the legislature, even though they keep trying to cut everyone in terms of education. So keeping those programs alive is definitely going to be something that is going to play a key role if elected. And a problem that I kept running into, which was hinted on before, was teacher salary. This might not be a district program, I mean problem. It is based on the state budget, because they keep balancing their budget off of district budgets. They keep taking away money that the community needs.
Thank you. Mr.
Rogers.
I think with the parent district doing well and have done well for many years is their hiring of top talent. I think that's attributed to our registration principals who are able to identify and attract good talent. We have excellent teachers throughout the district. I've gotten to know many of them. I've been very impressed with their passion for the kids. And it's all about the kids. And to have that so homogeneous across the district is quite an achievement. I think what could be maybe improved, as I referred a little bit with my daughter, having special needs, but I'm providing more resources, like Mr. Lemon also, to those on both ends of the spectrum. I think you do well in the middle. I think you do better on either end. Those honors, and I think those kids are making them, so that they feel confident and succeed.
Moving on to the next question, this time starting with Mr. Levin. Many school districts are eliminating certain classes and subjects such as art, music, PE, and cursive due to high stakes testing. Which of these subjects would you keep and which ones would you reduce?
Well, since we already have art, PE, and music in all our schools, I'm not sure about cursive. And I guess it's been a long time since I taught it. I don't see it in the workplace being used too much. So I guess I'm kind of at that point. I think it's important. It's a traditional education. But if I had to take my chances, I would eliminate cursive writing.
All right. Mr. Morales?
If I had to eliminate something, well, specifically, I think those social programs, which I was a big part of, including band and things like that, are definitely key to a student's development. So I would not like to cut those. I know STEM is usually placed ahead of that. But outdated programs, not just cursive, but things that the students aren't necessarily going to use at the college level and after graduation, things that will not teach them critical thinking, skills that they need in order to succeed in the future.
You know, I think there's some merit to cursive. It is becoming a lost art, that's for sure. I look at my daughter's and my children's handwriting, it's atrocious. At the same time, I think, you know, on the board, you constantly have to make decisions about good, better, and best. And I think what, what Patrick and Jen have already echoed, I agree with wholeheartedly. Those other programs, the social interaction, the development within mentally, physically, socially, is huge, especially on the arts side and physical education.
Okay, Mr. Gibson.
If I had to choose, I would choose cursive, but I don't feel like there is a need for us to have to make that choice. Certainly not at this current time. We're teaching it. Yes, there are high stakes in certain subjects, but I think that we can do all of this. There is a lot that cursive teaches a child in fine motor skills and in being able to communicate. It's not just about forming letters perfectly. So I would like to think that that's not a choice that we will have to make. If it came to that, I would choose.
Okay, for the next question, this time starting with Mr. Morales, what training or education qualifies you for a school board?
Like I said before, my entire day is spent on student issues, and I just want to expand that to K through 5th grade because that's the most important developmental stage for any student. You can't try to change their life or try to teach them cursive when they're already at the high school level. And specifically, in my personal family, I've grown around teachers my entire life. My grandmother was a teacher, my mother was a teacher. I hope to teach civics, and it's just a continuing tradition for me because it is so important for our community, especially because a lot of folks don't have the ability to go anywhere after high school. So we do want to make sure that they have that fundamental base.
Thank you. Mr. Rogers.
My love for children, my love for my own children, being a parent, and seeing my kids go through school, and being involved in the classroom, in some of my kids' classes when they come through school, interacting with teachers. I think, you know, you get to learn and feel and see the pulse of the teachers when you spend time with them. I think maybe professionally, at least my training in school at ASU, getting a degree in industrial engineering, gave me a lot of maybe background or backdrop and platform to solve problems. So, I think if there's anything that we do on the school board is not only enforcing and making policy, but also solving problems. You're constantly solving problems, and I do that day to day. So I think that hopefully I can bring that to the table to help solve problems.
Mr. Gibson.
We started off, as I talked about, BS in education. So I developed a love of children young. I have served on a number of boards for the past 7 or 8 or 9 years. Serving on boards teaches you how to work with people and how to effectively guide an organization while ensuring the financial success and that every voice is heard. You don't get to run an organization by yourself when you serve on a board. So I feel like that experience gives me a perspective on how to achieve goals within a school board issue. My wife and my stepson both went to Tempe Elementary Schools and on through the Tempe Union High School District. And I have worked in Tempe for the past 21 years, been a resident for 14 years.
Thank you. Mr.
Warren. Thank you. You know, like Patrick, my birth mother was a teacher, and my stepmother was a librarian. I'm a product of public school systems. I have a brother that taught public school. So it's important in my family because to get out of poverty and bad social economic situations, you need to have an education so you can get a job. And I learned that. I went back to school after a break with the Army. And I came back and I earned a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, and then a certification to teach me college systems, and then I served on a number of boards and committees, and I taught, and then I was asked to run for the school board. And I have a master's in the school board boardsmanship from the Arizona School Boards Association, plus one or two clusters beyond that. I take a week off every year to get additional training on how to be a better board person. And so I think that's what it is. Thank you.
For the next question, this time starting with Mr. Rogers, what should your district do to attract and retain the most highly qualified teachers for their students?
I think to attract and retain the most highly qualified teachers for our students is giving the teachers the resources they need so they don't struggle to figure it out on their own. And a lot of times the teachers are having to do a lot of work outside the classroom on their own without a lot of direction. I think more communication and processes that would allow them to facilitate access to resources quickly, that teachers are talking among themselves, or it's coming down from the top, administration down to the teachers. I think they'll retain our teachers and make them more valuable in the classroom.
Mr. Gibson?
We're doing a number of things well right now. There are certain things that we have to constantly improve because neighboring districts constantly improve. We have a great training and support for our teachers here. They get lots of professional development. So they may not be master teachers when they arrive, but if they stay for a number of years, they become excellent teachers. And that is one of the ways that we can retain our teachers is through the support that they get here that they may not get in other districts. Money is always part of it. We all have a mortgage to pay. And it's always concerning when our teachers live maybe down in Santan Valley because that's where they can afford a house. That means that sooner or later, they're going to go to work in Gilbert or someplace closer. So part of this is a bigger societal issue that they have to be able to afford housing close to where they work, at least in this city. So if we can do those things, I think we can retain more teachers.
Mr. London?
You know, this is an interesting question because it's something we struggle with all the time about attracting and retaining. Right now we have vacancies for teachers. Almost all the school districts do. That's because the economy is picking up and teachers are going into other professions. And Evan hit on it when he said we need to have them feel that support, that nurturing, that love, that they're an important part of the organization and to help the kids succeed. But, you know, aren't we talking about professional development? I've always supported professional development. When you go and get more education in college, you move up the pay scale in our district. I've always supported that, even in the tough times with our budget. But finally, we have to train people, those that can't go to college. We have to do that training, and we've made that happen in PD number 3. So we train a great cabinet of teachers, and all children throughout the state benefit from that because we lose them. And then we start all over again. And that's just the fact of life.
Mr. Morales?
It's been hinted at, definitely the money is something that plays into the teacher. Personally speaking, I would come home and like mentioned before, my mother would just do prep work and after school some more prep work for the morning after. And teachers aren't really getting paid for that. Yes, that's something obvious. But they're also not getting appreciated. Not often do the teachers see parents coming into the class after class and asking, how is my kid doing? The teacher isn't following up in that sense because they don't see the community involved. So I definitely believe that as a community, we need to come together and appreciate our teachers, not just financially, but in terms of support networks, in terms of volunteering, et cetera.
So, going back to Mr. Gibson, what are your opinions on the Move On When Ready program?
Move On When Ready is, to me, it makes sense that we need to ensure that a child is achieving at a certain level. It's always easy to push a child to the next grade so that we don't have to deal with what we may want to look at it as a child's failure, but it's our failure within the system to not educate them. We have to have some type of testing to ensure that that child is able to do work at a certain level and not just push them along. I'm in favor of it. I I think it works, and I think it probably needs to be an important part of our district, always.
Thank you. Mr. Lemon?
Thank you. You know, Move On on Reading is a state program, and we're mandated to do that. So if you're not reading by third grade, you're not getting out of third grade. I think the 11,000 students in TD3, I don't know how many third graders we have, but only three did not move on because they weren't reading. And that's a great tribute to the teachers we have, the focus we have in kindergarten through third grade to be reading. So I think that's important. But the other concept is Move On when ready. Will they be ready for fifth grade? Will they be ready for seventh grade? And taking a look at, will they be successful, or will they always be dragging behind and always challenged, and will the teachers always be challenged for that extra effort of the kids? We know teachers will do it because that's what we do when we teach. But that doesn't make it fun, and that doesn't help the other kids get that extra measure that they could use as well. And so I think that's one of the things you have to balance it out. So, thank you.
Mr. Morales?
As Jim mentioned, it is state law, so our hands would be kind of tied with this, but specifically, I think it is something that we should take a look at and be okay with, but not in the sense that we're holding back students past certain ages, because we also have to look at their social development. Again, we don't want someone out of age or something like that. But the balance does lie where we're not just graduating folks, we're not just passing them through the system, we are treating them as individuals and making sure that they are ready to deal with the next grade level, because often if the problem isn't met in third grade, it comes again the next year after that. So we definitely need to focus on the individual student to help keep that number down, which the district has done a great job.
Mr. Rogers?
The state has recognized something very vital. When a child can't read, they can't comprehend the subject, so they're going to start to fail. So I think it's good that this program is now in place and exists, and that with that program, they're hoping teachers focus more on the reading and their effectiveness in reading, so that will allow them to excel, gain their own confidence, self-confidence. I think it's great that, you know, we only had three children that did not pass. But I think there's no reason why we can't have zero. I mean, if the time is spent up front, every child should never read. And there's programs out there in place that I've learned about in the district that they're doing after school, they're taking one-on-one time with those children that they've identified that outside of those limits and spending time with them. I think if you do that, you do it carefully and with passion and love, there's no reason why we can't have any children that should be held back.
So starting with Mr. Levin, did you vote for the last bond and override? And if so, what other activities did you do to support the election?
Well, as I mentioned before, I'm a state employee, so it's very difficult for me to get very active in a number of issues in an overt fashion. But having been on the governing board and in official duties, we did recommend the bond election and the override election on the board, and I proudly voted for that, encouraged others to do so. So that's kind of where it is. It's, you know, our governor doesn't like the state employees working on other sorts of issues. And so my hands are a little bit tied, and you're not going to see my name on the literature. The treasurers of those campaigns may see my name on the check. Thank you.
Mr. No, I did not, because under my job description, we're not allowed to do that, because it is a nonpartisan organization. But I would support it, I do support it. Like I said before, I worked on the Proposition 100 and 204, which were sales tax to appropriate money specifically to education. So I am in support of that.
Mr. Rogers?
Yes, absolutely, I did, and I am in support of it. I'm fortunate enough to be associated with Susan Ashcraft, who's now involved in overriding. Now I'm signing my card, so I proudly display it.
Mr. Gibson?
Yes, I support the current override. I've supported every override since I have voted. Until we change our way of funding schools, overrides are going to be a fact of life. We have to certainly keep the money in
attend this district's schools?
Yes, that was my main motivation. I hope to have children next summer after this is over. So I definitely want to be able to provide for them the proper education. When I went to school, luckily I had my mom watching over me. She started out as an aide and then moved up, and now she's working on her PhD, so she was always keeping an eye on me, so I intend on doing that as well.
Mr. Rogers?
Yes, as I mentioned, when I introduced myself, I have four children. All my children plan on going to Tempe schools. I just lived down the street from Broadmoor Elementary. I love the school, very involved there. And my 8-year-old is now there in second grade, and a 4-year-old who's at ASU, the preschool there currently. So, yeah, I'm going to live in that.
As I mentioned, both my wife and my stepson attended Tempe Elementary and Fuchin High Schools. I have a 4-year-old grandson who will be going to Fuller.
Mr. Lovett?
Well, thank you. Julie and I were not blessed with our own children, but we hosted many foreign exchange students through Rotary. They lived in right here at McCllintock High School. They got on the bus and came to school every day. But I do support Tempe residents sending the kids to TD3 schools because I know they're great. I know it works. So I don't think we're planning on having any more children. So.
Starting with Mr. Rogers, do you have a plan to lower teacher turnover, and how are you going to keep good teachers from quitting?
What was the last teachers from being?
Of how are you going to keep good teachers from quitting?
Plan, you know, I'm still learning. There's a lot of issues I think it's taken us to need to take in and listen to. But I think providing the teachers what they need, as I mentioned earlier, as we've heard today, more resources, more training. You can't have enough training. You cannot give enough education to our teachers. You cannot give them enough resources to do the job. So I think that would be probably paramount. What I understand right now in my learning, and I'm sure that I've shown some of the school board members and teachers and administration in our district that all learn a lot more about how to, you know, put together a plan that with my fellow associates to help move things forward and retain those teachers so they don't quit.
Mr. Gibson?
Money sure would help. We have 800 classrooms in Tempe Elementary District. 400 of them have whiteboards. So we still need tools that teachers to make teachers as effective as possible. I mentioned earlier that we have great training and professional development. We have to continue to find money for that. That benefits the teachers, that benefits our children. There is no downside to spending money on professional development. So that has to be a constant aspect of our budget. And then we have to have a healthy economy and more taxes come in. The more taxes come in, the more that we can afford to pay people so that we avoid some of these issues that I spoke of earlier where our own teachers cannot afford to live in our community.
Mr. Lyons.
Thank you. I'll start with Harvey's remark about more taxes. Yeah, I'd rather have more control on time on hands, legislature. Let us decide what we're going to pay our teachers. Keep the buildings open, and that's where it's at. And so, but we're not going to do that. So what are we doing at TD3? Well, we're doing professional development. We're paying, if you get that college education, we're paying more. If you get your master teacher certification, I forget what the national organization, but we give a stipend or bonus to that. We've tried to support that years past. As a state employee, when they made us uncovered, they gave us a retention bonus and we were still there, and they paid it out over time. So that may be something that we could look at. If you stay with us and you get all your training and you're committed, we might look at a retention bonus, but it would take a long way to figure out how to do that. Thank you.
Mr. Morales?
Like mentioned before, we have put in place great programs for the teachers so far based on what we can do with the state legislature. But as a strategy and a tactic, I would honestly want to add to the training to some kind of way to mobilize the teachers, because there are a lot of teachers in this district that if we all just ask, yes, we're going to get a no, but if we do it for 3 years, then they'll start paying attention, because right now the districts keep asking for money and all they hear is the district asking for money and no one is ever at the Capitol asking for it. No one is fighting for it, and I think we can definitely add that element in terms of the training and hopefully start pulling in teachers instead of just having them leave.
Mr. Rogers?
I actually have a new question.
Oh.
I can answer it again.
Oh, okay, sorry about that. Oh.
I had some other thoughts. How about a perpetual housing fund for Tempe? So our teachers can live in Tempe and have a community.
Sorry about that. Okay, so for the final question for the elementary candidates tonight, starting with Mr. Gibson, what abilities would a student leaving a Tempe elementary school and entering high school have?
What abilities would they have?
Yes.
Well, I would hope that they would, besides being able to read and do the math, pass all of the college and career ready standards that apply to a eighth grader going into ninth grader. So besides just passing those tests, to me, it's important that they have the ability to figure out problems, to think for themselves, to do all those kind of abilities that cross not only boundaries of what they're interested in and what they will study in later life, but to be able to do certain things very well. Whatever field you go into, you have to be able to balance a checkbook. It may not be a checkbook, it may be online, but we have a lot of those kind of things that we need to teach, as well as teach our children to problem solve.
Mr.
Lyman? Well, I think when you look at the abilities from the children that are coming out of Tempe Elementary District, first off, they're ready to learn. And that's what we teach them. You need to be ready to learn every day. You also need to be willing to learn and take the advice and take that guidance from your instructor, your teachers, and the adults, and other students around you. Finally, I think they're good citizens. You know, one of the bad things school boards have to do is when there's discipline problems, we expel kids that bring drugs and weapons to school. It's that simple. We have a zero tolerance. So you're not going to get TD3 graduates that do a lot of drugs or bring a lot of weapons. So we're not going to send you kids that are a danger to your society at the high school level.
Thank you. Mr. Morales?
Yes, besides the standards being met, I do believe standards are set at the base level. That we just shouldn't aim for them as a ceiling. We base our education on them, but we can definitely move past them. So have that. And it was mentioned before, critical thinking skills and skills that are needed in everyday life. When I was 17, or I was going into college at 17, I had to sign away for a loan for $65,000. I had no idea what I was doing. These basic skills that a lot of folks don't know, how to do everything in the community, that's so important. The reason I'm here, the reason everyone is here, is because not a lot of folks are involved in the community. So we do want to have good citizens in Tempe that are being proactive to help TD3 and to help in throughout the city.
And finally, Mr. Rogers.
I concur wholeheartedly with what Patrick and Jim Harvey just mentioned. I think there's way too much time spent teaching kids how to take tests than there is teaching them fundamental life skills, as you mentioned. I think we need to take that folks away from test taking and take more time teaching the kids and helping them really learn how to problem solve, think through logically what's going on here, and not just how to fill in a bubble on a test, standardized test.
Okay, thank you. And now, if each of these candidates could offer their 60-second closing statement, starting with Mr. Gibson.
I get to always be the first. It's been a pleasure running for school board. I've been involved in my community for years. I enjoy my community. I live here, I work here, I pay taxes here. And so as I run for school board, what I look for was ways that I can make a difference and to help educate our children, to ensure that every dollar that goes into the district is used in a strong financial proficient manner, which it has been and will continue to be so. Try to stretch a dollar. We're never going to have enough money as we would like for education. But we do a lot with the money that we have, and I would like to continue that trend. There is more that we can do, and I look forward to helping with that.
Mr. London.
Thank you. I want to thank McCllintock High School for hosting this forum tonight, giving you all an opportunity to see us, because it's a lot of work, and I appreciate it. One of the things when you decide to run for the school board is what can I bring to the board, what can I help, and what am I going to do after I get off the school board? And I think that's one of the questions that we need to ask ourselves. What do we want as a community from our school board members? Do we want a community that teaches children for our future? Do we want a community that just passes them through to somewhere else? Or do we want to build something that's sustainable for now and in the future? You know, we rebuilt 5 schools while I've been on the board. We're rebuilding 2 more, thanks to bond money. We've also cut over $250,000 out of our electric bill by putting in solar panels. We have clean burning diesel fuel on our buses. We bus over 6,000 students.
Thank you. Mr. Morales?
Yeah, so personally speaking, I do like problems. I like facing problems. And on the national board that I sat on for the students, we faced tuition hikes, we faced interest hikes. On the state board, we had our budget slashed from $900,000 to $100,000. And I was in charge of finances for both of those. So I do want to come to the table ready to work in terms of fixing the financial problem, in terms of making the connections with the people that can get us the finances and that can help us, and focusing on the individual students. Like Jim said, not just focusing on passing folks, not just saying, congratulations, you're in third grade now, but saying, hey, you actually learned something. You're here to be educated and not necessarily to be taken attendance for.
Thank you. And finally, Mr. Walters.
Yeah, I'd also like to thank McCllintock High School and the Chargers, that all the students have put this on. This is great. It's one of my first that I've been involved with, so this is kind of a really neat opportunity for me. I think what has been said is, I would also echo, I think a lot of the test taking, I think, is, I know it's mandated by federal government, but I think we need to do more to learn about the kids, their needs, understanding their parents, their home life situations. A lot can be gleaned from that. And I think our teachers, the more that our parents can get involved with the teachers in the classroom, the more we'll know how to meet the needs of these children and have them be successful, build their confidence, have them feel special and wanted and loved in the classroom. I think we can do a lot more there. And that would be my hope, to understand that more and be more involved in that regard in the school board and help drive that change.
All right, thank you all very much. Let's have a round of applause.